not a mic that is going to amplify our voices. If you were wondering.
If it's, that's what I'm saying, if it's too awkward, just drop it. If it's too awkward.
This is a mic that is not going to amplify our voices. It is just to help people for the live stream. So thank you for suddenly getting so quiet. That's super helpful. So if you're in this room because you came to the Clampdown panel to be better understanding fascism, imperialism, white supremacy, then you are in the right place. Thank you for being in here. My name is Clare Bayard. I'm an organizer with Catalyst Project. I'm super honored to be moderating the panel with these amazing folks who I'm going to introduce to you in just a moment. And also want to let people know that there are pieces of paper up by both doors at which you can, on the way in or out, be writing up any upcoming events that you want to share with people. Want to let you know that right up front so that when we get into Q&A today, we can really focus on discussion and comments rather than announcing events. So we are going to be getting into it with these four brilliant folks. And what we've asked them to talk about with you today is basically what Linda Burnham was getting into in the opening around these long arc forces, imperialism, fascism, white supremacy, authoritarianism, but specifically both how do we be grounded in understanding the long arcs that they are, and also the current evolutions in order to be more grounded and stronger in our work moving forward. So we've asked folks to explore from their own histories, from their lessons and experiences, the movements that they've been part of, how they can better help us understand those forces and how to fight them moving forward. And we've asked them to talk on questions about helping us understand those concepts better. Is it working?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Why is it important for us to be understanding those moving into the Trump regime? Do we need to have unity on how we understand those concepts? Why or why not? And what is this particular version that we're moving into of these big picture forces? So I'm going to introduce the folks who are going to be helping us walk out better understanding and ready to get in there and fight even stronger and more effectively. We have on my left Melanie Cervantes from Dignidad, Rebelde. Next to her is Alicia Jrapko. She's from the National Network on Cuba, co-chair and U.S. coordinator of the International Committee for Peace, Justice, and Dignity. We have Linda Evans, who is a former political prisoner and organizes with All of Us or None, which is a civil rights organization of formerly incarcerated people and their families who are dedicated to fighting against discrimination based on past convictions and standing up for the human rights of those people. And we have Phil Hutchings, who is a member of the Black Alliance for Just Immigration, Causa Justa Just Cause, and a former member of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. So please welcome. So we're going to hear from them, have a little bit of time where they get to ask each other some questions, and then we're going to finish out with getting to hear from you all on your questions and thoughts on these topics. So we are going to get started with you, Phil.
Okay.
We have this one.
This one will be there.
So much 21st century technology here. In the amount of time I have, I was going to try to talk about two different things. One was a little bit about the history of the past, and particularly the history of the South, where we had probably the closest example in more recent times to fascism in the South during the 40s, 50s, and 60s. And in the second part, I wanted to say something about the current period and maybe a little something about Mr. Trump. And so starting out, I didn't actually get to the South until 1961. And I feel very lucky that I got there a little later because kind of after World War II, the late 40s, the 50s, and early 60s, the South was really a blueprint for American fascism. You had the ideology of white supremacy, the military in terms of the police, in terms of the state National Guard. You have the legislatures. You have the police forces, and then you have the masses, the kind of right-wing masses called the Klan. And probably the most important thing you had, in addition to those material factors, was the fear that they engendered in the average person, particularly the average black person. And so trying to even think about changing any of that, or even contesting it, one had to look at the question of fear at the very first part, because people in their recent memory had seen people lynched and hanged and their houses bombed. The ability to vote was pretty much non-existent. You had a county where at the best you might have one or two people who were registered to vote, and sometimes were intimidated from actual voting because they might lose their land and property, as poor as it was. And so by the time I got there in 1961, is that it was still very much the same layout, but there had been a few little cracks that were beginning to happen. You had a new president in terms of Kennedy, who hadn't done very much at that time, but there's a new kind of air coming in. You had black folks who had come back from the military in World War II, who came back home to the South, who had seen a little bit of the world and knew something, that there was something, some reality beyond just the South and their states of Mississippi, Alabama, Arkansas, and so on. And they had some fresh ideas. But there still was no real focus and ability structures to actually move forward. And the only group from the civil rights movement, the NAACP, National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, were pretty much in the city, main cities like Jackson. They didn't come into the rural areas. Particularly the famous or infamous Mississippi Delta region, where pretty much the Klan and the right wing was totally in control. So the real question is, and I think this is why this time and this panel, is to talk about how do people think about beginning to move forward and fighting back, and what are things that we can learn from that. And so the first thing I'd say is that you have to find some degree of sanctuary. And what increasingly stepped up to be that were many of the churches, because that was the only collective place that people had some history of getting together. And they went free. The churches got bombed, like they're still getting bombed in some cases. The Klan would monitor them, but they were there. At least they provided a space for people to have meetings in, to get together, and to actually have the beginning of some degree of formation of hope through some degree of structure. You had people doing cooperatives, and which was the second thing. They weren't openly political. They were basically self-supporting ways. And I guess part of this is, I'm saying this because I think it's something we have to think about also, is how do you find new ways of struggle which are not under an extreme right-wing position, openly challenging, but basically gives you some space for survival, so some space to grow. And also some space to look for new allies, people who maybe under a different situation might not have been seen as your folks or your group and people you would normally hang out with. And the new situation of outright terror, and pretty much they didn't call it fascism, it was just old-fashioned white supremacy or Jim Crow segregation, was the form that they put on us to do that. But you had to figure that out. And so one of the ways when groups like SNCC and CORE began to come in is we didn't come in doing demonstrations. We didn't come in like we're some big newcomers, the hot shots. We came in as basically wanting to see what had happened before. Whose shoulders were we going to stand on in terms of people who had struggled in the past, and what could they tell us? And who should we go talk to? I mean, they say, go talk to Mr. Tyler. He lives four doors over, because he used to do stuff. I mean, the word was used to. And our goal was to figure out what he had learned, what were the lessons, and how maybe could he get reinterested in getting involved again. And so I think, and I particularly here in the Bay Area, where we have, it's almost like a little Weimar Republic of the left, is that you take a lot of things for granted, the associations, the hangouts, and so on, and we have to, I think about lessening that a little bit and finding new ways to travel and new ways to meet people. And also have conversations with people we might not have had before. And we might have seen them in passing, or some of the organizations we might have called petty bourgeois or this or whatever. But given the, what I'm saying is, I'm raising out as a possibility of outright fascism, that you begin to think about how to develop new allies and begin to have certain motions. And then do things very small and pointed with people who know each other. And sometimes you, in the case of like Mississippi and Alabama, we get arrested. But you begin to try to develop in some infrastructure so those people could get out of jail. Our infrastructure was to develop Friends of SNCC in the North. People who could send money in and to get people out. To talk to groups like the National Lawyers Guild, who could help supply lawyers to come down and help. Because we didn't have those, that kind of structure in Mississippi or Alabama or pretty much anywhere in the South. And so, all I'm raising in the short part here is to say, we're getting ready to go into a new period of history, I think. It's going to be a kind of dark period of history. And I remember when I was in my first year of college, I read a book called It Can't Happen Here by Sinclair Lewis. And actually the play It Can't Happen Here was in Berkeley, I think in November, for about 3 weeks. But there were two lessons in that, in coming out of the book, at least that I got, was that, one, it can happen here, and despite that we're a special country, and we're a little different, the so-called American exceptionalism to the rest of the world, it can happen here. And it's increasingly happening as different areas of public space get closed down on, that the ability to participate is basically based on economic criteria. And the corporatization of the mainstream becomes more and more. And so we're even without a Mr. Trump, we're moving in that kind of general direction. So that becomes important. And I think one of the abilities of the civil rights movement to begin to fight the fear, which I said was the first part, begin to develop structures by talking to the people and listening to the people. We like to talk a lot. And so one of the things we used to say is, Grandma says, you know, you have two ears and one mouth. And you should basically proceed on that level as you do organizing. And the point is, you need to hear the people, because these are the people who've been here, who know the lay of the land, who know this, how the repression comes down, and also have developed defense mechanisms, which in some ways work, which means they're still alive. But the defense mechanisms don't advance the struggle against the opposition. And so you have to find out ways to get their trust by, and I think we used to say in SNCC, the only way that can happen is that we're going to be here with you. That if the boom comes down, we will take it as well. We don't have a lot of money. We don't have any big politicians to call down here or movie stars to come down here and have concerts and raise money and raise your thing, but we do have the ability to say that we will form a new kind of solidarity based on people having our hand in hand. And so if you've ever listened to some of the freedom songs that came out of that period, you know we talk about togetherness, being in jail and singing so loud that we could drive the jailers crazy. But finally, as I say, the thing is, how do you find ways to reach out and touch new people and get them involved in ways that don't turn them off, that don't necessarily rely on, I'm going to say this may be the wrong crowd to say it in, but don't rely exactly on ideology, but more on the experience. And it's more important that you're making, at this stage, when fascism is coming at you, that people are getting in because they feel hurt, they feel oppressed, they feel like we have something in common, than that we define that, well, you're a liberal this or a left this or so on. I'm not saying it's not important to know some sense of that overall, but in terms of one-on-one people relationships, that you don't want to do that. So I have how many minutes now? Two?
Zero.
Okay. Well, let me say one last thing, and we can carry it on in the period. Just because, in the back and forth. I think what's also new, and this is beyond the South, is that Trump is not a neoliberal. And basically, he's a neo-fascist. And there is a difference. And I think the day of neoliberalism, which we've looked about, we've talked about, we've studied, we have workshops on, we've looked at other countries, it's pretty much over around the world. And that the right wing, as people have noticed, is basically winning elections. The turn to the right is happening in Latin America, Asia, Africa, parts of Europe, Austria, which has been historically a right-oriented country, had temporarily resisted that, electing a Green. But by and large, it's a move to the right internationally. And that's going to mean more things, different things, rather, both economically, militarily, and how we see the world. And so I think that that's going to happen. The United States is, what the meaning of the Trump is, election is that the United States sees itself as the top dog in this situation, and that that's what we have to worry about and fight about. Thank you.
I have a problem here because I can't see you and my notes at the same time. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for coming. I think what Linda spoke to earlier today is really important, that we are the ones that have to decide. We are the ones that have to define a strategy for moving forward. And that's a really serious responsibility, and I'm really glad that there's so many people here willing to participate in that process. It's going to be a long process. It's not going to happen today, obviously. But I think that the connections and agreements, you know, the same definitions that we can come to today will help us move forward together. I feel like when I look at the news, I mean, we are in some kind of crisis of democracy, crisis of capitalism, crisis of the Constitution. What does that mean for us? How do we look at it and figure out what to do? I feel overwhelmed. I'm sure a lot of you do too. But the only thing that we can do is put one foot in front of the other and really learn from the mistakes that we make, learn from what we've done before, and try to share the lessons that we do learn as we go along. Because there is such urgency and such demand for us to really participate and take charge of the direction of our movement that we can't hold back. We have to be willing to take risks. We have to be willing to take to make mistakes. I know that one of the things that we really do have to confront is our own fears. If we're going to step forward and really take on the struggle against Trump, we're going to have to examine what are we afraid of and get past it. Because I think that the example of the civil rights movement and of the comrades that came before us is really, really relevant here. Recently, I read John Lewis's book called March. It's a graphic novel, 3 volumes, very accessible. I recommend it. And understanding how the resistance built at that mass level that included everybody in the community standing up is, I think, the lesson that we have to take. How do we build that same determination, that same bravery, that same courage to resist that the civil rights comrades, our leaders, our ancestors came to? How did they do that? I think that I want to share some lessons that I've learned from various efforts to organize in my life. And basically, there are 3 arenas that I want to talk about. One is I worked with the John Brown Anti-Klan Committee for many years, long ago in the 1980s. Some of you probably were just being born. But we directly confronted the Ku Klux Klan. And we were an internationalist organization. We worked against white supremacy in South Africa by fighting apartheid and against Israeli domination of the Middle East by supporting the Palestinians. We worked in solidarity with Native American people, with the struggle for Puerto Rican independence. So we understood that the forces of white supremacy, like Phil was talking about, are and always have been international. And for us to truly build a resistance movement, we need to develop communications with people in other parts of the world who have confronted white supremacy, perhaps under different conditions, but with lessons that we can learn from. So I think that's a very important part of what maybe a few years ago we would have called globalization of the people's struggle. One of the things that we did then, which was different than now, because of course we have the internet now, we didn't then, I know that seems unbelievable, but we didn't have it, was that we did a lot of personal outreach. And I want everybody to just think about that for a minute, and whether in fact that is not obsolete. You know, it's easy to send out emails, to do, you know, Facebook and Twitter and all that stuff. It isn't the same as organizing. I'm not saying it doesn't have a role. I think it's really important. Obviously, we need to use every tool that we can. But in terms of really changing people's minds and their consciousness, I think that we have to engage in conversation, in struggle with each other, in discussion, and that cannot be, there's no substitute for that. During that time in John Brown Anti-Klan Committee, the Ku Klux Klan in Texas, where I was working, was extremely public. They had a TV show on the community access radio station, TV station. They did marches. They had paramilitary training camps on national forest land. They were working hard to organize their people. One of the things that the John Brown Anti-Klan Committee did that was very successful in terms of changing people's minds was we did a door-to-door petition against the Klan training camps. Now today, you can get a petition signed online and get, you know, 100,000 or 50,000 or whatever signatures in a heartbeat. But are those people going to really confront the Klan? Are they really going to confront white supremacy? Do they have a practice of doing that? Do they understand how to intervene if they see a racist interaction happening in their local Starbucks, right? So I think that if we look at white supremacy today and the way that now there's no pretense of who is running this government, we have to look at the ways, at the various places that white supremacy happens. Some of it is in individuals. And I think it's incumbent on everybody in this room, if you see a racist interaction happening, act in solidarity with the person that's being attacked. It sounds like it might be easy, but we know that to intervene with strangers is not always that easy, but it's something we must do. It must be part of our practice. Then we have the organized Ku Klux Klan, the organized white supremacist forces. It's important to call them out, to identify them, and to confront their organizing. Obviously, we need to do that in collective, not as individuals, but it's critical that we understand how they're organizing themselves, what their organizations look like, there's many of them, and build a strategy to confront them wherever they try to march, wherever they try to organize. It's many places. They're organizing in the prisons, they're organizing pretty much everywhere. And I think it's really critical that we confront that organizational level. Another place it's going to come up is white supremacy in the state, right? We're going to have to call it out. Certainly, Vision for Black Lives, the Movement for Black Lives, Black Lives Matter, are leaders in that. And it's crucial that we follow that leadership. And I also have learned a lot of lessons from building a movement of formerly incarcerated people. And specifically, we've worked around Ban the Box. I don't know how many of you are familiar with that. The box refers to that question on housing, social benefits applications. Do you have a conviction? If you do, forget it. You're not getting anything. So we confronted that box in various arenas, housing, education, employment, voting rights, and all over the country, formerly incarcerated people started to build movement in their towns, in their counties, in their states, and has been incredibly successful as a reform. What we need to do, however, I believe one of the weaknesses of what we have built is that we haven't developed a political consciousness that goes beyond that reform to what is a vision. What is a vision of some of a better society, something that can encourage and inspire us, that we can work toward? That needs to be developed further. And I think also internally, there still are contradictions around male supremacy and around really how do we build something that's going to last a long time, that isn't dependent on individuals, but that has an ideology and a strategy that can move forward no matter who is participating or leading at any moment. The other thing I think that really the work around formerly incarcerated people points to is the need for that long arc. We still have political prisoners who have been locked up for 40 years. We all need to educate ourselves about those comrades and move forward to get them free. I just want to say one more thing about fighting white supremacy and the lessons that we can learn from the hunger strike, the California prison hunger strike, and from the agreement to end hostilities. Nothing is more divided than prison life. The state segregates us. We end up segregating ourselves because of fear, because of influences from the outside. And what the people did, what the people in prison did, was built unity. Out of the secure housing units, where people are kept in solitary confinement 23 hours a day, never get to talk to each other or to any other human beings, have no physical contact with another person. Under the worst conditions that you can imagine, they built unity and built demands. And they built solidarity with people on the outside that were able to actually move forward some of the demands and actually win some of the demands. It was a long struggle. People died. The agreement to end hostilities was a statement was a unified statement by the prisoners who started the hunger strike, by the comrades in the short quarter at Pelican Bay Prison. And it was a statement of common cause against a common enemy. And I think it's crucial that we understand their example, follow that leadership, and build that same understanding amongst ourselves, where we appreciate and respect the differences and learn from the differences amongst us. Keep in mind that the leadership and experience and expertise of people most directly affected must guide our work. And then we must build unity to confront Trump and his administration.
Born and raised in Argentina, but I came here a long time ago. I still keep my accent alive, so bear with me. I became politicized in my country during the 70s, but you know, I have been asked to talk about the experiences learned through the struggle to free five Cuban men who came to the United States. But I also, because the theme was fascism and imperialism, I thought that it would be good to share with you a little bit of my experience back in Argentina. I was as young as many of you who are here today, fighting for a better world. We were inspired by the Cuban Revolution, no question about it. A lot of movements in Latin America were, but we were certainly not doing any terrible thing or killing anybody at all. We were just fighting for justice, like many of you are. We were not expecting what came. You probably are aware that in Argentina in 1976 was a coup that basically ended with the life of 30,000 people. I did experience fascism in Argentina. I did. I lost many friends of mine. I was one of the lucky ones that was able to leave the country. And I'm here to tell you. But I just wanted to, I have a quote from one of the military in Argentina, in the city where I'm from. He say, quote, "We are going to kill 50,000 people, 25,000 subversives, 20,000 sympathizers, and we will make 5,000 mistakes." That is a quote from him. Many of my friends were those mistakes, and I think I probably could have been one of the mistakes. But, you know, this was not in a vacuum, and I wanted to say that the United States had a lot to do with what was happening in Latin America. You know, you may know about Operation Condor. That was military in South America getting together and going after people that are not even were in Latin America. They were going after outside their own countries. And I have to say to you that different administrations from the United States, Republican and Democrat alike, were supporting the Operation Condor. We have Johnson, Nixon, Ford, Carter, and Reagan administrations. And the support came, of course, through the work of the CIA. Today we are experiencing different tactics in Latin America. They're not the bloody coup that happened during the 70s. They are called soft coup, you know, like the one that happened in Brazil recently, in Argentina, in Venezuela, as you know, it's happening as we talk. But, you know, the strategy is the same, to destroy all these progressive movements in Latin America. And I wanted to bring this up because, you know, when I was in Argentina, we were not prepared for what was coming. But I see signs here in this country similar to the signs that we saw in my country during the 70s. And the fear that Phil talked about, you know, is a very important thing to think about, because the fear for us was propaganda of what are your children doing, make sure that your kids are not doing anything wrong, the neighbor that was looking at you saying you're doing something wrong, you know, things like that. But, you know, we were not prepared for what came. Nobody could be prepared for that. And I just wanted to highlight that. I'm going to transition a little bit to have enough time to talk about the case of the Cuban Five. I also wanted to bring what Linda said about the importance of building an international movement, which was the case of the Cuban Five. I don't know if you know about the case. I'm not going to talk about the case because, first of all, they are back home. It was a victory, but, you know, it happened. Linda was involved very much with us. It happened because people from all over the world were really hard to free those five men who were innocent. The Cuban people were behind big time. It was a huge campaign. But they didn't tell us what to do. The Cuban government didn't tell us what to do. We knew what we need to do. We need to build a movement in the U.S. For all of us who were here. Now, this was a rare victory because, as we know how hard it is, the work of political prisoners in this country. Yes, President Obama signed the release in 2014, December 17, President Obama and President Raul Castro signed something that was moving towards the right direction, which is changing US policy towards Cuba. And the Cuban Five, all of them, returned home then. But it wasn't because of Obama or anybody else in the administration were nice enough to say those guys are innocent. It was because people fought really hard to make that happen. And you know, that's the only way that we can do it, is fighting and fighting. I wanted to tell you about a little bit about my experience. I don't know how much time I have. A little bit of our experience in building the movement to free the Cuban Five in the United States. We was working with anybody, no matter how they thought, no matter how, if they agree with us politically or not. They didn't have to be supporting of Cuba or being socialist or being progressive even, you know? But they were all understanding the injustice of the case of the Cuban Five. And that's how we build it, you know? We had to do things we didn't like. We had to do lobby, which we honestly, I don't know about you, but we didn't like it. And, you know, and we learned how to do it because we have to reach out to all the, I mean, we didn't have money to do lobby, but we thought if we go and talk to the staff people of the of senators and Congress and explain to them who the Cuban Five are, they will tell them who the Cuban Five are. And it was another sector that we need to reach out. But I tell you, I don't think that that, obviously that didn't do it. We are part of an international movement, but it's not. And we were able to bring along different forces that really made a difference. And we are very fortunate that this happened because it's an example that is possible. It's an example that is possible. Now, going to the next period, I have a few things to say. I hear, I came at the end of the first plenary presentation, and I like what the presenters say about, in the goal is to defeat Trump, okay? But how are we gonna do it? And I think we all here talk about building a movement to do it. Now, as much as we would love to work with everybody, you know, and build this movement and all the different struggles that are happening in the United States, how are we going to do it? We need to talk about how we're going to do it. Because if the option is to elect a Democrat president, you know, I think we need to move beyond that. very progressive forces inside the Democratic Party, but the party is not the solution, it's part of the problems. So we really need to move. I mean, in thinking in Latin America, the leaders, Evo Morales, for example, in Bolivia, he was a leader of the movement. We don't need them. We can have our own leaders in the movement if we build a movement with all the different forces, and we can present our own, you know, candidates to be president. I know it's a dream, but you know, maybe in 100 years it will happen. But no, honestly, it's not that far away. I think we can do it. We can build a movement where we can bring our own leaders. If we think that the elections is the way to do it, we can do it. So I just wanted to end it with an advertisement. Tonight, we are organizing an event to honor the life of Fidel Castro. It will be in La Peña at 7 p.m. Most of you know where La Peña is here in Berkeley. We have some flyers to pass, but we're going to have speakers from different struggles because we are thinking in the same way. We want to connect the struggles and to see how the legacy of Fidel help them and how linked to the struggle, because there are other societies like Cuba that is organized in a different way, but it's a much humane system. We can learn from them. We have a lot to learn from them. So I will end it with that because one of the main things that get all of us together in solidarity with Cuba was what Fidel said, that unity is one of the most important aspects. to move forward. So the last thing, I'm working in this publication, it's called Resume Latinoamericano, that has news in English about Latin America, about the United States, and about the Middle East. We have a weekly newsletter that if you are interested, you can just write to the email address, EnglishResumen@gmail.com, EnglishResumen, and we can send it to you. And this one is all about the blockade in Cuba, and we have copies to pass. Thank you very much.
Thanking my screensaver for outing me as a nerd. I had a couple of chances to go downstairs and use the restrooms. I know that's all why you guys came to hear me speak. And there was graffiti in one of the stalls that said, "Make America Indigenous Again." Turtle Island was and always will be indigenous, and I want to start off by acknowledging that we're on a lonely territory. That if we're going to be having these conversations, that we have to come in with a consciousness about settler colonialism and where we sit, where we stand, where we speak from. So I want to do that in a way that's respectful to Ohlone ancestors, but also to the Ohlone people that still live, breathe, pray, and have survived many, many things. I'm gonna share a little bit of arc of history of political graphics. I'm a cultural worker. It's kind of like a bouquet of flowers. You could pick a ton of different kinds of flowers. Every bouquet is a little different. I'm limited on time, so I picked a few flowers that I thought were interesting. I wanted to start in 1937 with the Taller de Gráfica Popular in Mexico. They were founded by a group of artists like Leopoldo Méndez, Pablo O'Higgins, and Luis Arenal, among many, many others. It was a collective model. The Taller, the workshop, was primarily concerned with using art to advance revolutionary social causes. And they had a document of principles. And one of those principles was that the TGP believes that in order to serve the people, art must reflect the social reality of the times and have unity in content and form. And so they operated collectively to serve many different left causes in Mexico, the Communist Party. They worked with Lázaro Cárdenas. They worked with many different groups that approached them for support, and people would go to them seeking support to translate these visions that they had into political graphics. And they did this in a time and in a country where literacy was a challenge and communication technology wasn't widespread and it wasn't accessible to everyone. And so they created images of revolution and resistance, and they often had, because of the political moment they were in, images on anti-Nazism and anti-fascist messages, and they printed these as leaflets, as flyers, and as posters in order to create a unity of message that people could access. Because of visual literacy goes back to time immemorial. We look at the petroglyphs throughout the world, and we've been telling stories this way as long as history has existed. And so the TGP created posters like the one on the right, which says, "A week of help for Spain," as a way to raise funds to support the Republican forces that were battling Franco's army for control of Spain. And they really believed that they had to help fight the fascists in Spain if they were going to be protected from fascist intervention in Mexico. So I think this is an example thing of what has been talked about earlier, about like we have to have an internationalist orientation if we're really gonna make the kind of changes that we need to make. And I think this historical example is really illustrative of that. I'm gonna fast forward 30 years. It's in 1966. The Organization of Solidarity of the People of Asia, Africa, and Latin America was a Cuban non-governmental project that emerged after the Tri-Continental Conference happened. And they created a publication that was about combating imperialism, globalization, and neoliberalism, and US aggression. And they did this with the countries, leftist countries that were non-aligned, so they weren't like part of the Soviet bloc, and there were definitely internal colonial communities that were representative of the US, but not representative of the US as an imperial force. And they founded this group as one of the ways that they could create a communications arm, you know, similar to what the TGP was addressing. Was this was a way to share information, to collaborate across communities, and to disseminate information. And it was a time of armed struggle. So many of the images that you'll see the characters or the depiction of armed struggle. So like this poster on the right says, "We will destroy imperialism from the outside, they will destroy it from the inside. August 18th, Day of International Solidarity with African American Peoples." So these were really awesome because, you know those like teeny bopper magazines, they have like a centerfold, or you know, there's other magazines that have centerfolds. This was just as sexy. These were the centerfolds in their magazines. This is what you got. You got a poster every time you got a magazine. So they had, I mean, there's just hundreds of graphics that they produced on struggles in Palestine, Laos, Vietnam. I mean, there are so many things happening in the mid-1960s, and these became kind of visual reference for those struggles. Militant communication about the vision for what is possible. So these are, I think, predecessors for the work that we've been doing in Dignidad Rebelde. As I said, we're located here in the Bay. Our studio's in Oakland. We're kind of in the midst of being priced out and moving to another studio, but we'll stay in Oakland, and we're gonna fight to stay. And we have oriented ourselves as Chicanos, as a Chicana, in a way that recognizes that we have indigenous and African ancestries, but we are not on our ancestral homeland. We are guests on a lonely territory. So it's been really critical in that practice of making cultural work, of creating graphics that are about vision and analysis and politics, that we orient in a way that solidarity is an action. So the works that we make, for example, this piece on the right, that may be commemorating something that's gonna happen, you know, that's happening, that's important, like the launching of Occupy in Oakland that came, you know, months after what happened in New York. It was an opportunity to serve the community that we really hold dear, the indigenous community here, by reminding folks where we're standing and by kind of complicating the narrative of occupation, right? And this was one of the ways that we did that, by giving up this work, because we really believe that if we willfully participate in that collective amnesia, like if we're only talking about housing but not talking about settler colonialism and how things have been expropriated, land has been taken, that we're participating in the violence of forgetting. And that violence isn't just symbolic, it has a material reality. This model of collaboration, much like the TGP and OSPAL, to help support grassroots social movements, grassroots efforts to do a lot of different kinds of work, including supporting the efforts to create a land trust for Ohlone people to have a revival of cultural lifeways. A part of what is important in the politic also is as we're understanding what struggles we're engaging in is to really think, you know, like the struggle that's happening at Standing Rock, as much as it was about water and as much as it's in the context of climate change, it is first and foremost about indigenous sovereignty. And so for us, we had the opportunity to amplify movements, and that was like really the purpose. We came back from like a once in 10-year vacation that we had, and got to work to really amplify the voices of the folks that were organizing on the ground, and to really kind of fight back both against the construction that was happening with DAPL, but also this larger, longer, deeper fight around indigenous sovereignty and supporting that. And part of what we were able to do is both raise the awareness through visual storytelling of what was happening on the ground there, but also we were able to do grassroots fundraising and solidarity work by engaging with the very youth who called out to their community to say, we need to do something. So we were able to support the Osetie Shirkoi youth and allies in their work. Like they did a run from Cannonball all the way to Washington, D.C. to deliver petitions asking the Obama administration to step in. And they continued to organize that way at those steps where they decided the next thing they were going to do, we asked, how can we help? What can we do to serve this effort that you're doing? And it was simple things like, can you design a t-shirt? Can you do a flyer? And we answered those calls. I think the other thing for us to really think about settler colonialism in an international perspective, and to really think about the Israeli occupation of Palestinian territory as the most contemporary and critical fight that we have, that we're seeing live in real time. I think as Chicanos, many of us are in diaspora. We're the products of that repression, right? We don't know the names of the tribes that our people came from because they cut out our ancestors' tongues. And so when we look to Palestine and we see the grave violence that's happening and the inherent abuses of human rights and the disregard for international law and just basic human decency, it's incumbent upon us to act, and to act again in the ways that we can in solidarity, because settler colonialism is a mode of domination that is happening globally, and we have to understand how the forces are linked. One example, actually, Isaac reminded me of this story because he told me, while we were in Standing Rock, apparently people that were getting arrested at the actions that were happening there were being arrested with zip ties that were bought at Urban Shield. So that Urban Shield happened here in Alameda, where the county fair happens, where I eat cotton candy at the county fair. They're, you know, selling these and training folks in repressive strategies. And these are the same places where folks come from other countries. They have teams that they send from other countries to both train in repressive tactics, but also, you know, to learn from what's happening here and take it back wherever those places are at home. So when we start to listen, I think when we remember that we have two ears and one mouth, we start to be able to make the connections and connect the dots between the places where we lend our feet on. And so for us, when we do that, we find a way to tell stories that that opens up possibility for that solidarity of action, right? That ability to do things. This is a mural that was created collectively by myself and Mohawk artist and an artist from the Yukon in occupied territory that's called Montreal now, but has been known as Shoshake for time immemorial. And this was on a street called Colonial Street. Colonial Street. It was a liberated space. We did this without kind of like official sanction from the city of Montreal. And did so in order to really articulate what it means to be in contemporary times and addressing issues like the role that Indigenous women have in freedom struggles, in liberation struggles. And so we collaborated doing this sweet pace. There was a crew of us that that put it up. And you can't see it really well here, but there's a photo of a woman from Lindsay Delarond, who's Mohawk from Ganawage, which is the reserve that's closest to Montreal. And it has the name of Montreal, Jrapko. There, and it was a way to reclaim space, both in the act of creating, you know, this wheat paste mural, but also in the message and the stories that were being told. You can see kind of Turtle Island. It says in Spanish, Tierra Indígena, which was interesting because this was the side of an auto body shop, and there were a lot of the workers in the auto body shop were from Latin America, and they came out and they were telling all kinds of stories. We did a few different murals in this area. And to me, that was exactly what it means to be able to open space through these kind of mechanisms that we might not have had the opportunity to get to know the auto body workers. You know, like we were just putting up murals and whether or not that conversation would have started, I don't think so. I don't think there would have been kind of the space for us to interact that way. So I offer these as an invitation to take more creative approaches to build. We're gonna be, you know, we're facing a time of and a threat of great destruction. And I think the most powerful thing that we can do in that time is create.
Take a couple minutes for you all to get to digest the panel before we come into questions and answer. So turn to someone around you, maybe it's someone you don't know, and just talk for a few minutes each about what jumped out at you. What are you thinking? What questions come up for you? What does this mean for you? And then we'll come back together and get a chance to share some questions and thoughts. If you're on the live stream, don't leave. This is a great minute to stretch. So much we want to talk about with each other. Let's keep that going all day today and beyond. And for this panel, we just have about another 15 minutes together. So what we'd like to do is take a sweep of maybe three or four questions that then folks can respond to. If you are someone who tends to feel really comfortable talking in an auditorium full of people, maybe practice the two ears part of the one mouth. And if you're someone who doesn't usually do that, maybe this is a great place to take a risk, because we're also building collective courage. And that said, let's also keep your question to a condensed nugget that can fit into a minute. I will give you support around that if you need it. And remember that we have a place to list events as you're leaving out the doors. There's big paper, you can write up events you want people to know about. That'll get compiled and shared with everyone, not just the people in this room. So, who's got some questions or thoughts that you want to share with folks? Okay, I see one, see two, three, four. Let's start with that and see how far we get. Yeah.
Okay. I had a question about how we navigate conversations with people that don't share the same position or ideas that we do, and how we navigate it in a respectful way where we are acknowledging their ideas and approaching it where we validate their ideas but share our own and kind of come to an understanding and not, I guess, not come at it as a defensive.
Thanks. We'll take all three for now and then let them respond. Where was our number two? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. First, I want to thank everybody on the panel. Each and every one of you were absolutely wonderful and inspiring. I would like to ask a question which is related to the title of the workshop. We haven't defined fascism. And I think it's important to do that. We are confronting a highly authoritarian system that, in my opinion, has come out of the, quote, neoliberal forerunner of it. I wonder if we'd all be sitting here if Hillary had gotten elected, and I think we should be sitting here if Hillary had been elected, but I don't think we would have been. But I just wonder, I was born in a country, Austria, that became fascist as a child, so I have some ideas about what fascism is.
Thank you.
So thank you all for sharing, and thanks for hosting this event at such an important time. I just wanted to raise the issue of political prisoners and see if someone could make an announcement as to how to go about, maybe all of us could just pull out our cell phones right now, and I think it's a really critical time to tweet or write to the White House about, you know, maybe you could mention a few names and more about how the best way to go about that.
So let's start with the, oh, did I? Yeah, sorry, please.
Thanks, of course. And my question is about, a lot of you are talking about like learning from other movements and like internationalist stance and learning from there. One of the things that I struggle with is living in the Bay Area where I don't want to leave for all the obvious reasons. I'm not having a lot of challenging conversations because everybody agrees. And so I'm wondering, like, yeah, how to have those conversations, but, like, how to find those conversations? Like, not online, right? Not on Twitter. How do we, like, engage? How do we get to a physical place to engage in those conversations without leaving or camping?
Great. So this is a great start. So we've got having challenging conversations with people that you may not share politics with, including how to have more of those, including with people outside the Bay, probably also here as well. Action for political prisoners, and what is fascism? So. And we have about 10 minutes total, so let's try to share that among people.
Yeah. I'll speak to the political prisoner question. Thank you very much for bringing that up again. quickly, we have some of the political prisoners who are freed have been meeting and trying to strategize about how to get our comrades out. One of the main problems is that many of them are in state prison, and consequently, Obama has nothing to do with it. If you want to support and take action right now, you can go to whitehouse.gov and email the president. Obviously, you may know these names. We are supporting the demand for release for Leonard Peltier,
yes.
For Oscar, of course, Oscar Lopez Rivera, for Metula Shakur, and for Veronica Bowers. Those are the people that we know who are political prisoners, eligible for release, have either submitted clemency petitions or have made other advances in the campaigns. We're really, really hopeful that Obama will take action on those prisoners and also on many, many others, in particular women who have been not granted clemency in the same proportion as the men have been. So that is something that you can take action on immediately. Here in California, we still have political prisoners who have been locked up for decades. Chip Fitzgerald is one of them. You can go to freechip.org. He's going to the parole board in February, and we really need support, many forms of support, financial support to get a lawyer for him, as well as letters to the parole board. There are other places that you can access information, particularly at Jrapko, Jrapko Movement, Jrapko Amnesty Movement, I believe, .org, has a complete list of the political prisoners, and I really urge you to educate yourselves about them, to write to the prisoners. If any of you want to come to me and give me your contact information, I will be happy to send you information about how to contact them.
I was just going to say a couple brief things about the conversations, how to have conversations with people who are different from you politically. I would say, I think the first thing is you're not trying to win an argument. You're trying to establish relationship. Keep the focus here. And that this is something that's not going to happen in one time or one day. And so what you're trying to do is see yourself as in relationship to something that this person or this group of people have in common. Maybe sports. It may be opera. It may be just something around value, spiritual values. Or actually having fun, whatever that might tend to be. But the point is that you find some way to continue and build upon contact and keep the thing going. I used to play tennis, and what comes out of this is that you want to get the ball back across the net one more time. You don't quite know how it's going to turn out. But the idea is, they say something, you get the ball back across the net and keep it going. And then events will come up in terms of the country, the actual, that begin people. But you can talk, you already know them a little bit, and they know you a little bit. They don't know you just as this lefty or this very political robot. But by and large, you're real human beings. And so I'm saying the challenge is to come up and develop real human relationships with people that you don't know, and which you might actually like, get by people that you like. You may not like your position and so-and-so, but as the moment the party is, this is a real human being, and they're likable. And I think that begins to expand, and then you get the courage to find some other people in that grouping, and you expand. In fact, somebody, I think it was Angela Davis once said, courage is contagious. And you get the crack in, and you keep building. And so that's what I would say, is that you're not trying to win something, because it's a new terrain for you, and you're probably a little different than what you're used to also. So the question is, how do you to develop relationships? And I don't think there's anything unnatural. You decide, you know, people stand out how you like, what you have in common, beyond politics. I mean, that's one of the problems I find in politics, is that if you don't agree with somebody politically, what use are they, you know, in some ways? Because you have nothing else to talk to them about. Mm-hmm. And we have to expand that concept of who we are, who our practices, and how we work.
Just expand a little bit about what Phil should say, because I think that the most important thing is to be inclusive, and they find things that we have in common, because, you know, believe it or not, we have more things in common than differences when we are fighting for something. So I think it's very important that we include everybody in the, you know, in this period that we are coming to, and have conversations with them. I'm not sure about your question in the back, because we all have the same problem. I honestly don't know anybody that voted for Trump. You know, I don't. So we live in a bubble, really. But we also, I think that there's a lot of things that we can do together, because I I think that the concept of unity, you know, that we need, even if we all think alike, they still need, we need to do a lot of work to unite the different forces to fight together.
Yeah, I want to add, I guess I'm surprised because just in my family, there's such a broad political spectrum, and they're here in the Bay Area. I have more family here than where I grew up in Los Angeles, and I have those same challenges. What am I going to talk to them about at this wedding? There's only so far. There's two conversations about the weather, what you've been up to, and then we get to the politics, because everything is political. Everything we do is political, and it is challenging, but I think one of the things, when I think about my family, because I think there it's so much more of a struggle, to not treat people as disposable, because that's the very thing that we're fighting against. When we don't agree with folks, even when they do awful things, that we not practice that disposability, the idea that people are trash. I've seen that online. And I think it's a horrible rhetoric to use and to participate in. When I think of my family, I think I love them. I disagree wholeheartedly with them. And I think they disagree wholeheartedly with me. And they must think, how am I related to her? The way sometimes I think, how are we related? But it, starting with that place of but I love them. They're my family. And for me, it's been about kind of coming to understand, how the deportation of my grandparents created such a deep trauma and pain that catalyzed different responses in different parts of the family. One was a hyper-Americanism, USA, please don't, I think underneath that is please don't ever reject us this way. And then the other is the things that I do. And so I just wanted to offer that because I think those are things I struggle with. And I'm not perfect or right because I still don't see them that much because it's really hard. And so that's a challenge that I have to confront too. So I just wanted to offer that.
Do you want to define?
Oh yeah, no, I'll just define fascism. In 30 seconds or less. No, we do want to keep deepening our understanding of what is fascism. We want to keep having those conversations and to keep having them in a way, as we were seeking to do here, that is actually not abstract. It's not about some detached academic definitions. It's actually about real people. It's about our lives. The people who are moving an agenda opposing us are also humans, and our complicated families are humans. And the movements we're building are made out of humans. So we want to keep having those conversations and keep grounding it in human experience, building collective power to change our futures. And the sad thing is we're out of time for this conversation, but the exciting thing is that we were really just starting to move into the, okay, well, what are we doing? What do we need to do? How are we going to do it? And the next set of sessions is really towards addressing that. So we're going to have a 15-minute break, and at 4 o'clock, there will be the three different sessions that you see in your program.
3 o'clock.
3 o'clock. Sorry. The break is not that long. 3 o'clock. Thank you. And we'll continue.